Because if that word in relation to is defined in 14a to mean direct and indirect, then how you can change its meaning for book profit? Or to put it in the language of a poet, what is sauce for the goose is sauce for the gander. कि अगर वो वहाँ वो चीज़ है, तो यहाँ भी वही होगा. So same word, same meaning. See the interplay between this principle and the understanding, the conceptual. In fact, our answer was that taxing of book profit conceptually is a legal fiction. See, there's a very fine distinction. Taxing of book profit is a legal fiction, conceptually, because no one taxes book profit. Book profit is distinct from your statutory profit. You get, in fact, see, more interesting, if you see the Hyderabad special bench, rain commodities, 40 SOT 265, you can't reconcile it. वो उस बिचारे का deduction नहीं दिया उन्होंने 54 वाला, because उसने अपने P&L में दिखा दिया था as a profit on sale of that asset. So they applied Apollo and reverse gear to them. They said, if we can't touch it, means revenue, then you also cannot touch it. You must read Rain Commodities. It's Hyderabad Special Bench, 40 SOT 265. There the SSE showed the profit on the sale in his P&L. But then he said, see, I am eligible for deduction under 54. So I'll remove it and then pay MAT. The special bench everyone said nothing to it. Apollo in reverse gear, and the second this, what I said, ki then the purpose of that Hayden's rule now comes. Taxing book profit will get lost. Artificially you would have got out by taking the statutory deduction of 54. So there's no finality. So now same word, same meaning, and conceptually taxing book profit, which is a legal fiction, but the method is not a legal fiction. If you can appreciate the distinction, the method to tax it is real. It is based on accounting policies and accounting standards. The concept is a fiction. I also agree. Ki 20% tha, 30 kar diya, and what is a book profit? But the method to arrive at it is based on real. It is based on accounting standards and accounting policies, which you have to state before your shareholders, etc. So same word, same meaning, you see how it has come into play. Now, that is the rule.
Your special bench, you are with Delhi, hearing is lower?
No, it's going lower. It's too complicated, it will one more hearing.
So,
you're
talking about concession?
Okay, now very good. We should just, my friend has pointed out now, in Goetz, India, 361 ITR 505, the issue came up that, because this is very important for us from a consultant point of view and revenue, ki when faced with the clear language, the Delhi High Court writes like this, when faced with the clear language of clause F of explanation 1 to 115 JB, the learned counsel fairly conceded. Now, this word, fairly conceded, has become the bone of contention. It is based on a concession, and the settled law is that a decision based on a concession is not a binding precedent. Why? It is only for its peculiar facts and limited to that. It cannot be what you find in 193 ITR 321, Radhaswami Satsan. Because all lawyers cited, if you have allowed the fundamental facts to continue for 1 year, you cannot argue. But if you see 193 ITR 321, the Supreme Court is very quick to say below that this decision should not be cited as a precedent in any court of law. It is being given on its peculiar facts, which no one cites because it doesn't suit them. Don't do it because don't mind it. We are all human beings. Who doesn't want to win? But then there is a judge above us also. Why? He cheated in his eyes. Why I am saying this? Because someone very senior said this. Then some of us got up and said to one of our judges that yes, that is there, but just read below that also. So why? Because we are in an intellectual forum. And actually I am saying, the idea is you should be able to achieve victory win a case, not by default. So very well said ki learned counsel fairly conceded. Now it is a very open question. What is a concession? Concession is on facts. Suppose there is a difference of some fact. Now see, this is only one view. I don't want anyone to agree with it. But just listen to me or just bear me out. Concession is that facts are slightly different and the counsel makes a concession that let the law apply. You can't make a concession to law. Like 143.2 has not been issued or has not been served upon you. You can't make a concession on that. That even on merits I will win. You will win on merits. So here actually the interplay is fairly conceded. Now fairly conceded talks about professional ethics also. When he realized he could not argue, he fairly conceded. So it is a grey area that what the Delhi High Court meant. But interestingly for you, another good case is a Supreme Court decision, Pillaiyya's case, 60 ITR 411, where they said suppose a authority merely repeats what a subordinate has said, then that decision is not illegal. Why I'm explaining to you Pillaiyya is, in that case, the High Court merely repeated what the tribunal had said and went against the taxpayer. And the taxpayer took up this case in the Supreme Court ki High Court did not apply its mind. Tribunal had passed a well-reasoned order. They said, we agree with the findings of the ITT. So the Supreme Court said, yes, it was better for the High Court to have discussed it in detail, but merely because they agree with the reasoning of a subordinate authority per se does not make the decision illegal of that. Now, if you apply this principle to what Rahul said, suppose the High Court merely says, when we asked him on the clear language of F, relatable to and you increase it and all, he fairly conceded. Otherwise, had I been there or someone, he would have written that the learned counsel could not answer. Now, doing all that does not put him in good light or had no answer. And since he had no answer, we hold against him. That is one way of writing it. And a more, way of writing with etiquettes was fairly conceded. So they gave him respectful standing. Why put him down in the eyes of the client? Then when he goes, the client will say, what are you giving this check for, bill for 2 lakhs? For saying fairly conceded, okay, you could not answer and you could not give any distance. See, clients also are intelligent. Then you would have said, I would have engaged someone else. So, anyway, but that fight is going on. Okay, whether it is a concession and it has no binding value, or whether fairly conceded only meant in terms of professional ethics, okay, he fairly conceded. See, when you cannot argue, what do? You don't sit quietly, you go on to the next point. Anyway, so this is same word, same meaning, that unless the context is repugnant, if a word which has already been judicially understood or defined in an earlier provision of the same act, then this will take color from the meaning assigned to it. And that is why that quote is there, that if text is texture, then context is color. So the text is the same, the texture, the context is it will take color from that. So this will be same word, same meaning. Okay, let's do non-obstantive, then we'll come to use of last antecedent after that. Non-obstantive is notwithstanding anything contained in any other provisions of this act. So naturally, and the distinction is, the other one is a diluted one, without prejudice. The other way of putting it, but at a milder level, is without prejudice to that. But the first one is the strongest, that notwithstanding anything contained in any other provisions of the act, and then it's used. So naturally, you have to give the importance, privacy to that section, which says notwithstanding anything contained. And the third is same as otherwise provided in other provisions. So these are the three different colors. The strongest is the first, without prejudice is there, and then same as otherwise provided. Because same as otherwise provided means there is interplay. Both can exist. Same as otherwise provided. So non-obstante creates a problem Now it is for C, map, because it says notwithstanding anything contained in other provisions of the Act, and then it comes. But by the same breath, it tells the officer what you have to reduce and what you have to increase. What you have to reduce, it is interesting, in two you will find. If he has brought exempt income on the credit side in JB, he has to remove it, because then only it will match, because the expenditure is getting increased. So this is, although it begins with this, but later down it gives the leeway, the freedom to do that, and this is where the gray area comes in. That will you read it in isolation or will you? And now, because of this fight, see how interesting it is, section 5 got inserted. In 115 JB, 5 got inserted. Other provisions of the Act shall also apply, I think. See, for the interest and other things. So this is very interesting how we have been doing it, cutting and then adding and then taking out. Fine. Huh. Save. They say save as otherwise provided in this section. This takes care of everything. All other provisions of this Act shall apply to every SSE being a company mentioned in this section. This was brought only for the other group, because then SSE started saying we are not liable for this interest, we are not liable for this. So then this was brought in. So this explains that although it has a non-obstante clause, but then now save as otherwise provided, you would. So to that extent, there has to be interplay. And why I said this is only the continuing battle of wits between the SSE and the taxpayer, that you take slightly more than what is intended, and then the tax administrator thinks this was not intended, so you amend. And then you keep on amending till you have achieved the objective, going to the extent of going to 1462. 14A is that example. You all must have noticed it begins with that. Think from the inception of the Act. It's a very rare case where the Act was amended and it begins by saying from the inception of the Act. It is interesting, we must note why. Actually, there was a debate in the tax planning legislation that if you don't amend it from 1462, then a message will go out that you did not mean to apply these provisions for the intervening period. So they made it 1462, but then in deference to the hardship it would cause, the 147 clause was put. You will not reopen an assessment only to give effect to 14. Because then the fear was that officers left right will start reopening to give effect to 14A. So that is why first was to put the law as it is from 1462. It was always meant to be that, though misunderstood by Supreme Court in Rajasthan warehousing and Maharashtra sugar. But only to obviate the hardship that we would open for 8 years or 6 years, they made that saving clause that you cannot reopen it merely to give effect to 14A, only if it is in some other proceeding that you are doing and it comes. So that is how you strike the balance. You state the law as it always was and understood to be, though misunderstood by judiciary in between, in those three cases. So India Cements, I think, then Maharashtra Sugar, then this Rajasthan warehousing, that was the last. And then they decided to amend it. So,
since you are on 14A, but sir, do you not see this is causing hardship also?
Yes.
Expenditure may, dividend may be 22,000, but the disallowance is coming in lakhs. In Godrej, it was argued, and judge said, unless there is a madness in the rule, it cannot be held unconstitutional. But they have not accepted that. But in practice, we are seeing that the disallowance is much more.
There is a reason. The decision is Rajiv Prasad Modi, 115 ITR 519 Supreme Court. In fact, I'll give you the answer in one line. Why an expenditure to be profitable need not be an expenditure to be allowable need not be profitable. That is the issue. See, there the shoe was on the other side. The SSE had a loss and he claimed the expenditure. So the officer said, look at the wording of 57 for making or earning income. He said, where is your income? I'll not allow the loss. So that was the other way. Then when it went to the Supreme Court said, you have to allow the expenditure. So what if there is no income? Now it is the other way. Just because there is exempt income, you mean to say your expenditure will not get disallowed. And the corollary to that is, just because you didn't get the exempt income, so what? The expenditure was there, disallow it. That is why 83 uses the word may or shall, from which the income shall be exempt, means ultimately it will be exempt. So it is actually the what they call in law flip side of Rajendra Prasad rule, Supreme Court decision. Uska ye sequitur hai. Logical conclusion uski yehi hai ki agar aapka loss hai, kharche allow ho gaye, to agar income humne exempt kar di aur income nahi hui, so what? Expenditure to disallow hoga hi uska. Now the issue is, can you disallow the whole of it? It's very complicated. That we can do. I'll do it in the end because there is an answer to that also. Because of 14A overriding what I said. 36(1) is other. After all, aap kahan pe claim karenge? You will come in 36. What is 37? Residuary. So how can you claim it when 14A has overriding effect? But yes, I must admit very fairly, your entire expenditure gets disallowed, even I am disturbed. But that is the only answer, is there is no equity of taxation. The only answer is in that. Because if you go down to that, then your income tax is, you cannot hold it. That is the only way income tax can be explained in a civilized society. It is the ability of the rich to suffer the burden and take care of the poor. That is why the rate is progressive. It is not flat. Otherwise, there have been cases in the US that do not follow progressive. There the rich feel very strongly about it. They say, yes, we will pay tax, but keep it flat. So, but now Mr. Obama wants to change that. But India follows the progressive. Means, the more you earn, the more you pay. That is your ability. So anyway, now, legal fiction. Now, this is very interesting. In constitutional law, you have a class after this, the professor will come. There's a very famous quote that Parliament is supreme. It is sovereign. It can do anything except make a man or woman. This is a quote of Dicey, and it is taught in constitutional law. Then there was a professor, Jennings, very famous, Sir Ivor Jennings. He came after Delhi. So he wrote, Parliament is supreme, it can even do that. But it is so supreme, ki it can even do that. Why I explain the logic is, and this is a real example of legal fiction. It is the earliest case of legal fiction. It is based in Mesopotamia. It will be in 2-3 century BC or something. And this is recorded history. I have read it from a book on income tax evasion. How legal fiction started from the West, and it has come to us in the 22 Act and then just. Legal fiction actually in Mesopotamia, they say that there was a kingdom where the river, there was no bridge over it. And the king's subjects were very unhappy that every time they had to cross the river, the only way was to swim, you know, or take a boat, which was very expensive for them. They were at the whims of the boatmen. All because of floods, boats could not go. So actually, they went and the king called the finance minister, the wazir of his kingdom, and said, find a way out for this. So the wazir said that the only way out is, we don't have the funds, but something like BOLT or that. What we will do is, we will build a bridge, raise funds, and impose some sort of a tax, toll tax. So the bridge came up and the toll tax was put. Then after 6 months or a year, the king was surprised. He saw his finance minister looking very sad and with a long face and very worried. So he asked, what is the matter? He said, Jahapana, no one is paying the toll tax. He said, why? He said, they decided it is good to go back to the old ways. That is, either swim or go in the port. So the king asked his minister, what have you thought about it? He said, I have an answer for it. You will have to put a board on both sides. And the board was, this is actual, anyone who crosses from the left to the right bank, and on the other side it was from the right to the left bank, by any means, that is board, swim or any other means, shall be deemed to have crossed the bridge and pay the poll tax. That is the first case of people in the world. They say, ki then the collections picked up and the rest is. So remember, legal fiction is only done when the administration thinks there is no other way than to this thing. So, for the purposes of the, it shall be deemed to be this. So the legal fiction is created, but there is a very good inbuilt limitation that a legal fiction is always interpreted strictly. You do not go beyond the fiction. That the legal fiction is to be interpreted strictly, you do not go beyond that. And better example I'll give you in income tax. You'll have to just tell me very quickly because it can go. 45-4 is one of the best cases of legal fiction. See, all of us are tax people. In a partnership, the principle of mutuality is there, that there is no separate existence. That is why the old law or the classical law was, you cannot make a gain with yourself. So the partners of a firm on dissolution could not make a gain. Why? They were only getting their share in the common hodgepodge. This was the understanding in Sunil Siddharth Bhai, Supreme Court, Malabar Fisheries, Supreme Court, Devas Sine Court, Supreme Court, all of them. Now Parliament found that people were taking undue benefit of this. That you put everything in the firm, and when the assets have reached a very good this thing, dissolve the firm, sell off everything, you will get it. See, again capital gains. And then you will say, how can you tax me? I only got it as a share from the firm, and the firm is nothing but a compendious name given to the partners collectively. So 45-4 was enacted by way of legal fiction. And if you see the words, it says by way of dissolution, and the second word is very important, or otherwise. Only to take care that by any method there is this thing of assets, it will amount to capital gain. And that is why the deeming part is the market value. Usi mein hai, in working it out. Now what would be the cause? The market value. They mentioned it in this section. So 45-4 is a very live wire example of Parliament changing the classical law. In Sunil Siddharth Bhai, Malabar Fisheries, the last Seneca, we used to follow all that. And then this decision came, 1487th amendment came, and then you had this type of litigation coming. And then, this is very important for you, there were two schools of thought. That transfer definition in 247 was not touched, but in 45-4 it got touched. So it will be excluded. Few tribunals took the view and gave SEC benefit. Now this, which we'll do later, I can do it here. Transfer has been defined only in a general way, includes. It does not say means and include. That is exhaustive. Had it been defined as means and includes in 247, then the intention could have been said that this is not transfer. Like income, 224, it is only inclusive. There is the famous case where they said it can have as many connotations as you can think of, like that fruit and the tree example they gave. That is income. It does not say means and includes, only includes. So it can have, that is why capital gains gets taxed. It's a capital receipt. So it is only an inclusive definition of transfer, 247. That is why I said these rules are very important. If we had quoted the rule to the bench then, in those cases where we did in others and we won, that just go by the principles of statutory interpretation. Means and includes, exhaustive. You can't look outside, no external aid. But only includes, you can. The general connotation cannot be lost off. You have to keep it in mind. So, legal fiction, I think, the best is 45-4. It has everything in it. So you can take that and mandatory and directory be done. Then construction of conjunctive, disjunctive and last.
Excuse me. So when there are two legal fictions, then how do we identify 450C?
See, you will have to, again, as I said, the context, and in a case where you will have to see that the second principle is you cannot stretch it. So you will have to see that in 45.4, they have given a self-contained, no? How do you calculate it? As if it were the market value. Now, yes, I understand if you take that to, in conjunction, you are stretching it too far. And the purpose of 50C is only for those immovable property transactions where there is a difference between the stated value and the stamp value. But then there are clauses that you do the valuation, which I cited the Jodhpur bench, Vaidya's case. Where is it? That case of Jodhpur IT, Mr. Sayal's decision. Vaid's case is there. So there is a way out. Or where there are cases of what you call distress sale. 50C doesn't apply. Now there's judicial case law on that it's a distress sale. So if you take it to that, then you cannot. In fact, there is another case that in assets, Manjula Shah, the special bench, that also is legal fiction. We were saying that you cannot bring it into the assets which you have inherited in taxation. But Manjula Shah goes against the grain. It says, no, you give him the benefit of, well, he didn't even own the asset, and give him the benefit. And Manjula Shah has been affirmed by the Bombay High Court. I understand.
Yes.
Whereas I was on the other side. Because we said, we were interpreting it by limited fiction, that you only get the benefit of holding for short-term and long-term capital gain. Meaning thereby that you may have held it only for 1 year and you dispose it, but the period for which it was held by the earlier gets telescoped and you get the benefit. So do not extend the benefit. But they have said, you know, you cannot curtail it. Logically it will apply. So Manjula Shah is one, and the other one is that Meghnad Vaid by Sirvanti. So those will be the principles that govern it. That is in fact the importance of the canons of statutory interpretation. Disjunctive and conjunctive is and or. When and is used, that means it has to be conjunctive. And or is, it breaks it. That is the disjunctive part. But as I said earlier, sometimes courts have interpreted and to include or. And or to include and. Why? Again, because of the object. And if it leads to some absurdity. So, the object of the thing is the main guiding principle. I'll just see, I've taken out a case. Let me just see which are these. Manjula Shah, I believe, is the best example of carrying the legal fiction beyond the required, which we felt. But you are right, because the logical part is that you give him the benefit of indexation. This is a good case from income tax only, that in section 42.2 of the IPI, but this is the old act, 22, the result reduced by reading or as or could not have been intended, and the word or was read in the context as meaning and. So the general principle is that whenever there is ambiguity and the result produced by reading and as conjunctive, then, as they say, no, courts will supply the necessity, the doctrine of necessity applies. They will read it as or. And same will be when or is used and the intended consequences are not what it is to be served. Then it will be read to be conjunctive. But in the normal sense, and is conjunctive, it binds it, or would be, it breaks it. And it is separate from that. Now, from that comes that rule, egestum generis. This is needed because in the schedules, you will find all the items are discussed. And then people say, this is also included. So the rule for egestum generis is, from this only, and in all flows, the common thread should be running in all of them. If there is a break, then the rule does not apply. The rule of egestive genus. Like they give the illustrations in a schedule that these items are to be given the benefit of section, let's say 80I, that and the like. Now when the word and the like is used, that means Parliament only intends you to take the benefit of the other examples given which have a common this thing basis. And there was one more example I thought, okay, in and or was, I'll just read out, it's very clear. In section 7 of the Official Secrets Act 1920, which reads, any person who attempts to commit any offence under the Principal Act or this Act, now here how see or becomes, or solicits or incites or endeavours to persuade another person to commit an offence or aids or abets, and this word and became the issue of interpretation. Does any act preparatory to the commission of any offence? The word and printed in italics was read as or, for by reading and as and, this is what I meant, the result produced was unintelligible and absurd and against the clear intention. Why I have underlined it is that these are your three tests, that the intention should be clear, result would be absurd and unintended. Then you will change it. Then it will not be and, it will mean or, and vice versa. Then or will not mean or, it will mean and, because the result was unintended or it will lead to an absurd this thing, and the intention was to convey something which is not being conveyed by the thing. So this I thought was the, now the last one in this is construction of general words. There's only one interesting case we done. Actually, there's one act where just the reverse of our ATI, where you need 10 workers or 14. So this act applies where 50 people are employed. And the word was industry, but later it was factory. So naturally, when the government in England wanted to apply it, they took the plea that it does not mean factory, it means the industry. Means that with less than 50, they would get away with the conditions imposed by that act. So here the general word was, they said no. The idea is to convey that if you employ 50 or more people, you must follow these standards of safety and other things. Now merely because factory is used here and industry there, you cannot go into legal distinction that industry is wider. Like we have it in I think where ATHHC, it comes profits of the business and profit of the undertaking, something like that. There the SSC has got the benefit till now. So there they said no. In general parlance, they were interchangeable. I meant factory, though I used the word industry. So general word used, but in the context in which it was and the purpose which it was, for public safety of the workers and the standards to be maintained for their welfare, we would read it as that. And this is how it is. Just one add. In a case relating to section 26 of the Factories Act, which enjoins occupiers, occupier in legal sense is the person who is responsible for the, in the factory, to provide safe means of access to every place at which any person has. In fact, in company law, occupier is the one who is responsible for tops. It's a very big responsibility, the occupier. The MD of the company has to designate, or the company in its resolution designates a person as an occupier, and for all legal purposes, he is the person responsible for any omission or commission that takes place for the corporate entity within every place as occurring in the session was to be found, which were restricted. So this is it, that by general, we will not read it down as the company wanted it to be there. So this is one good example of general, this thing. Then we have this, we'll do it very quickly, and there's some hot tea for me. See, general words, the best example I give is N.C. Buddhi Raja's case. That dam, is it an article or thing? Now, see, the poor man lost in the Supreme Court. Think of the interest he must have paid. He was willing. AO held it not to be eligible for the deduction because he said it is not an article or thing. And they said, no, it is an article or thing. So, see, there, now remember that famous quote, do not make a fortress out of a dictionary. There his lawyer was very hard working. He took the dictionary and proved it to the appellate tribunal in Odisha. I think it's a case from Odisha. CIT appeal held against. Then from ITAT, Odisha High Court held in his favor. But when it came to the Supreme Court, this is that famous quote, do not make a fortress out of a dictionary. You have to give words their normal understanding. And in a normal thing, a dam cannot mean an article or a thing. So that was the thing, that generally as it is understood, N.C. Buddhi Raja, that is the leading decision. I'll give you the citation, Mr. That is why when you litigate, you have to be very intelligent also. Because either you pay the tax upfront, because in a huge case like this, he was wiped off and by the interest of you. 204 ITR, 412, N.C. Buddhi Raja. Now I'll answer Sharmaji's thing. See, you must accept one fact, that in a 14A, there's a lot of gray area, all right? Now, I'll be very frank, the best way out is segmental accounting. Now, everyone doesn't do. If you do segmental accounting, I'll be very clear, the provisions of 14A come to your rescue. The AO should be satisfied, it says. Now, how will he be dissatisfied if you have segmental accounting? Now coming to the second part, for to be a very free, fair exchange of ideas, what the lawyer or the CA committee should contend before the AO is simple, the logic of G.K. Dreidenschaft, that you want to apply 14A in my case. I am demonstrating before you that 14A doesn't apply to me, my accounts are correct, I have factored for direct and indirect expenditure. Look at my audited accounts, these are the things. And below that, you must write that in case you do not agree with the above, a opportunity of being heard may be afforded to us before deciding this issue. And then mention, keeping in view the legal jurisprudence enunciated by the Honorable Supreme Court in G.K. Dreidenschaft's case. Why? Because that is actually where the Supreme Court really has helped the taxpayer. 148 nowhere requires, 147 nowhere requires. What was the classical law as stated by the Calcutta High Court? That after you have filed the return, you ask for the reasons. And they stopped at that. Supreme Court went a step further. They said no, after you have filed the return, you ask for the reasons, then you can object to that. And AO is duty bound to hear those and dispose it of before coming to the final assessment. So, in case you can do this and show to him, but now see the dispute will be what he, my learned friend says, you will not account for indirect expenditure. But there is a school of thought that, you know, there are hidden expenditures. For instance, I'll give example and you can rebut it. When you take, suppose a company investment company, you have invested 200 crores in your subsidiaries or in other things. You mean to say you will just let it be like that? I think there must be constant monitoring, P by E ratios, or especially for another publicly listed company. And all of that, suppose there is a team, who is going to do the time management exercise? Because as they say, capital and time both have economic value. Now, who is going to ascribe an economic value? You will say that we have on our board of directors, like Mr. Balkiwala was employed by the entire Tata Sons only for this. He had to sit half a day there apart from his legal practice. So who will give an economic value to that? So actually that third limb is not only income tax, it is what they call public finance, applied economics. That some economic value is there, and that is that 0.5%. Now naturally you will contend, I have not spent 0.5%. It is not your spending, it is the value which the time and then the management has spent. And you know, because I can't believe, I've seen balance sheets where 200 crores, 500 crores is invested. And then the size of the dividend, you must appreciate the quantum of the dividend. And to quote what my learned friend said, that Shakespeare's quote, there's a method in the madness. The method in the madness is actually this, that you have to give some economic value to this. You cannot make it zero. And second, you will appreciate it more, all of us. How can the size of the income determine the disallowance? Suppose all the companies in which you have got shares do not decide to give dividend, but reward you with bonus shares or with a rights issue. You mean to say your expenditure was nil? And there will be inconsistency. 1 year, there will be, let's say, few crores of dividends, so 0.5% of the dividend. Next year, there will be zero dividends, so we'll say no expenditure. The team is in place. So the logic was, you link it to the corpus. That is why half of the average value of the investment. That is the logic. Income will change. So suppose somewhere there was 10 crores. So no tax. Then 0.5%. And zero next year. So no tax. How can that be?
There is a permanent intention.
See, the point is, very well said, dominant intention. That is why other, the word other neutralizes. Then second is, that the fact that you did not